Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2023. We've received apologies from Alex Rowley for this meeting and I welcome Jackie Bailey, who is attending as his substitute. Jackie, could I please invite you to declare any interests that are relevant to the committee's remit?
No relevant interests to declare, convener.
Thank you, Jackie. We'll now move on to substantive business for the meeting. And this morning, the committee will look at monitoring COVID-19 recovery. And I'd like to welcome to the meeting Alfred Trevedortier, the lead spending review and machinery of government, and Indra Bambalet, junior policy analyst from the Organisation for Economic Cooperation and Development, both of you join us remotely this morning. Good morning. We estimate this session will run up to about 10 past 10 and each member will have approximately 10 minutes to speak to witnesses and to ask their questions. I'm keen to ensure that everybody gets an opportunity to speak, so I apologise in advance. Therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members just or witnesses just in the interest of brevity. Can I invite Alfred and Indra to briefly introduce themselves? Alfred, do you want to go first, please?
Thank you very much for the opportunity to be with you here today. My name is Alfred Trevedortier, and I am a senior policy analyst at the OECD, and I'm leading the work, as you said, on spending reviews, machinery of government, and performance budgeting.
Thank you, Alfred. Indra, would you like to come in?
Hello, everyone. I'm Indra Momoleite. Work at the OECD on performance budgeting and spending reviews.
Good morning and thank you. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may begin with the first question. With the COVID-19 rules and restrictions lifted in Scotland, there's obviously been a reduction in the quantity and the quality of available data, although I know that data is still being published on a weekly basis and still offers some insight into COVID-19 trends and cases. I'm interested, Alfred, in your view of the Scotland COVID-19 recovery dashboard, both during the height of the pandemic and currently following the lifting of restrictions.
Yes, thank you very much for this very interesting question. I mean, this is something that we have been discussing quite extensively with the countries that we've been working with. And I want to note to begin with that, unfortunately, we've not been able to directly work with Scotland on a bilateral basis. But of course, we are quite familiar with the system in Scotland. We have worked with neighboring countries such as Ireland, for example, but we wanted to note that, I mean, the dashboard is obviously excellent. And I mean, what we found really relevant for the dashboard you have in place is how regularly it's been updated. I mean, that's really good, how frequently you update the data. And I mean, I would say that it's quite similar to what many other countries have been doing. Many OECD countries have been doing something similar. But I think that most countries are not updating the dashboard as frequently anymore. I mean, of course, as they're heading out of the pandemic and other more important things have been happening that need to be responded to. So, I mean, that's what we see. And just to give you a bit of a context of how Scotland compares to other countries. We also wanted to note that, I mean, it was, of course, extremely important to have the dashboard during when the pandemic reached its peak, so to say. But what we see in other countries is that now they are kind of, as I said, focusing a bit less on updating, doing such updates to a COVID dashboard, but more on kind of what can be learned from the pandemic and how countries can recover now. I mean, that's the most important thing, how to get out of the pandemic. So this is what we see, just to give you a broad context of that. I don't know if Andrew, you want to add anything, but I mean, I think now we really see that what we interestingly see is that countries are focusing on the public finances side. I mean, what has been spent during the pandemic? Is it one-off expenditure? And how do you, if it's one-off, how do you find ways to kind of like get that, I would say, is it needed now when countries are trying to recover from the pandemic?
Thank you, Alfred. That's really helpful, and you've actually answered my second question in with that as well. And I know in the previous session, Alfred, in September, you gave evidence to, on the committee's pre-budget scrutiny, and I know that you mentioned that many of the nations are now looking at scaling up their spending review process. Firstly, can I ask you, how simple would this process be, and how well do you think the Scottish Government is placed to do this? And just on another note, for this to happen, would it need to come from both changes from the, both the UK government and the Scottish government? I don't know, Indra or Alfred, if you want to come in on that.
Yes, we'd be happy to come in on that. I mean, this is a really relevant topic that we are working closely with many countries on exploring, so to say. And I want to note, first of all, as you we discussed the last time I met you, I mean, the Scottish spending review process, similarly to the UK spending review process, is a bit, it's not quite the same as what most other OECD countries have in place. I mean, and there are both pros and cons to the process that you have in place. I mean, it's extremely linked to the budget process. As you know, I mean, you just like it's a part of basically setting the budget. So, I mean, you discuss with ministries or spending entities that you have to X amount of savings, and then you do that. I mean, what is the, I would say, the weakness within the Scottish spending review framework is that, I mean, there's this lack of focus on baseline or existing expenditure, which is, I mean, something that definitely needs to be tackled now more than ever, I would say. And what we saw as, I mean, during the 2008 crisis is what countries use spending reviews extensively to do this. So, I mean, to scale up the use of spending reviews, yes, I mean, definitely it would have to come from the government. I don't know if the scale up is the right word in the context of Scotland, because, I mean, I think, as I said, you have an excellent process in place. It's just not focusing on what we would call a spending review should be focusing on, which is tackling legacy spending. I mean, how do you really look in the extent, like, you know, the what can not the waste of expenditure, but you know what I mean, like, you know, there are so many spending areas that you can really find room to reallocate to higher spending priority areas. So, I mean, that's something that I would encourage Scotland to look into, because you both can have this process that you have in place today, which is really good to have this as part of the budget setting process, and then also put in place kind of this. And I think if the government would explore something around those lines, it would be really beneficial for Scotland.
Thank you very much, Alfred. That's really helpful. I'll move on to Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Thank you for your evidence this morning. Can I just pick up on a couple of the issues that the Convener started by highlighting? You mentioned a moment ago, Alfred, the comparison with 2008 and how countries responded to the financial crisis at that time and the differences we've seen. Can I just ask you to expand just a little bit more on that and what lessons we can learn from the responses in 2008? And is there a different approach being taken now, either in other OECD countries or in Scotland?
Yes. Thank you very much. I mean, this is an extremely interesting question and something that we've been analysing or looking into at the OECD. I mean, it's the important thing of learning from crisis. I think that's what we did not do extensively after the 2008 crisis, how to respond to crisis. And I think that's quite obvious today. That's kind of what we see, at least with countries. But I think the difference, of course, I mean, the main difference, I would say, between those two crises is that, I mean, immediately after the 2008 financial crisis, there were just fiscal consolidation measures right away. I mean, that's kind of what happened at that point. Now we see that, of course, during COVID, countries just have been spending a lot of money, and no one really knows where the money has been going or how it's been used. I think that's the problem now. And now countries are kind of like, I mean, what are we, like 2 years into or two, 3 years afterwards, countries are waking up and thinking, okay, now we really need to do something to respond, because there is not enough, there is not any space to respond to any extra public financial needs. So I think that's, of course, the biggest difference between the two crises. And this, I mean, I think like the sharp fiscal consolidation measures that took place in 2008 and talking about spending reviews in that context, I mean, they were just used to cut expenditure rapidly. And I mean, that's also not really good because they were not really maybe done in the correct way, so to say. I mean, it really hit countries afterwards. So I think, I mean, I think we would say just that's the biggest difference between the two crises, but we are kind of afraid that now, I mean, countries will be having the sharp fiscal consolidation measures this year, next year. This will really be hitting hard. And then, of course, with, I mean, the energy crisis and everything else on top of the COVID crisis, that's even more expands the need for some sharp fiscal consolidation measures. And that's why we are talking to countries about the importance of having a really, I mean, having basically good budget practices in place. I mean, you need solid spending review practices. You need to be able to analyze baseline expenditure. You need to have good structure around the budget. Importantly, I have to note also that after the, what is the good thing that happened after the 2008 crisis is that, I mean, many countries really improved their budget structures and implemented medium-term expenditure frameworks, spending reviews, performance budgeting. So this is really proving to be beneficial today. I don't know if this completely answered your question, but this is, I'm happy to take any further questions that you have.
Yes, thank you. That's really helpful. And just to follow up on another point you made in response to the convener, I mean, you suggested that there were areas of spending pre-COVID that perhaps were not as important or perhaps not as well targeted as they could have been. And these have just been carried on with. There's not really been an attempt by the government to look at how effectively money has been spent. Have you got anything particularly in mind when you say that? Are there any examples you could give us of areas of spending you think perhaps needed to be looked at more closely rather than just being rolled forward?
That's a really good question. I mean, I would say I come from, I'm a former budget person in the Ministry of Finance in Iceland, and I would say like every spending area needs to be, I think there's waste within every spending area. I mean, so I don't know if there's anything really specific that can be mentioned in context of Scotland, but of course, I mean, I guess it's countries are similar in that way. But I mean, there's just been, in every country, there's been steep increase in, like I'm talking about, of course, OECD countries now, there's been just an increase, gradual increase in every spending area. I mean, I think that's kind of what really needs to be touched up on. If you are, I mean, you really need to just take stock and say, now we have to think about where is this, like, because you have the same discussion. You have, there is not enough money in the system, but still you have the increase in the spending and basically, I would say, every spending area. So, I mean, I think this is really what governments need to take stock of and say, like, if there's this increase in spending and there is still this, the gap between the need and expenditure, what can we do to respond to that? Is spending, I mean, is it not being used as it should be used? I mean, that's a question that I think every policymaker should be asking themselves today. Mm-hmm. But I don't know about anything specific. I would say that's my kind of, just like in every spending area, there's quite a lot of waste.
Okay.
I mean, yeah, you can find room basically everywhere.
Okay. I appreciate that. Probably wasn't a very fair question to ask you. It's really our job to find the waste in the Scottish Government's budget, not yours. I've just got one more question, if I can, and that's trying to look ahead. We've been through the COVID pandemic. We may have more variants of COVID, more strains. We may have another pandemic. Do you think governments across the OECD, and including here in Scotland, are doing enough to plan ahead for a potential future pandemic that might come?
My gut, like, I would say no. I think that's the biggest, and that's maybe what I wanted to mention also in relation to the first question in the beginning of the session on the dashboard. I mean, I think now it's really important to learn from the crisis, and I think that's the most important thing, because I think we all agree if another pandemic were to hit countries around the world, we would not want to respond the way we did the last time that COVID hit. I think that's a really important thing to, and I think we have to learn, countries have to learn in many ways. I mean, both, I mean, and I just from the budget side, I mean, it's really important to what, because we know what goes into the budget is really difficult to get out of the budget. And I think that's the most important, like, how do you really see what is the urgent need, one-off expenditure, and then what really needs to be in the system for a longer time. So that's just something that really countries, I think, they really need to. So my answer is, would be no, I don't think countries have been doing enough. But and I think they might have done maybe more if there wasn't kind of a crisis on top of a crisis. I think kind of if they would have been able to follow through with the COVID and there wouldn't have been another crisis on top of the COVID crisis, maybe then. But I think then we come in, I mean, it's also responsibility of international organizations such as the OECD, the IMF and more to really be able to assist countries in that way.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Jackie Bailey, please?
Thank you very much, Convener. I wonder whether I could ask you about Scotland's national performance framework and how you think that's linked to policy decisions, if at all.
Maybe if I just quickly start, and I'm sure that Indra, who's the performance budgeting expert, will also jump in. But I mean, I think our country, we were looking at it this week, the performance framework. And as I said in the beginning, unfortunately, we have not directly worked with Scotland, hopefully in the future. So, I mean, we haven't analysed it in the details that we would have wanted done. But I think the most important thing is that, I mean, you have an excellent performance framework in place. That's, I mean, you have... We would say you tick all the boxes and, like, you know, you have good indicators, you integrate other aspects into the performance framework. But what is the missing link from our side, and feel free to correct us if it's not right, is the missing link to the budget. And I think that's kind of like, you know, you have this two standalone framework, so to say, not frame, I mean, the budget process, and then you have that really good performance framework. And I would say, for parliamentarians and other, I mean, decision makers, there would be need to be a clear link between the two frameworks. So, I mean, that's the first thing we wanted to say, that at least from our kind of analysis, we saw.
What you appear to be saying is the framework is good. There's sufficient level of detail there. But it's the linkage with the budget that's missing. Is that similar in other OECD countries, or are we outliers?
You're definitely not outliers, but what the countries are trying to do, I mean, I think, like, what is the... So, I mean, you have the countries that implement performance budgeting, as you have done, and they just directly implement it within the context of the budget, which we would say is good. And then you have the countries, such as yourself, that have kind of like two separate frameworks, which we would say is like, it gets difficult to take into account what's put in the performance framework when you're making decisions around the budget. I mean, you don't have to, and this is also to be noted, I mean, if you fully integrate the two processes, of course, you risk there's overflow of data, and I mean, it's going to be difficult to analyze. But doing it in a kind of like a subtle way, and at least highlighting key performance indicators, what's driving the main kind of the big spending areas, is really important to have within the budget. And then also just so integrating those, so you're not an outlier, but I want to still say that countries are striving to integrate those two processes. So I would say many, and I mentioned Ireland earlier, we've been working actively with that, and actually doing this exactly. So, I mean, and then many other countries are also trying to do the same. So,
in order to achieve that, and given what you know of our national performance framework, is there a level of more detail required, certainly on public display, or is the broad form kind of detail that is there sufficient?
I would say that you would need to dig a bit deeper, I mean, for the performance information, I mean, because it's good to have have information about the big picture, so to say. But I think if you drill down, and we've been actually working on kind of like the level of detail you need for each, I mean, performance, what can you say, layer. So, I mean, I think if you really, I mean, because you have the budget, you have the budget allocations, and it would be really good to see some link between performance data, performance indicators, and the allocations more in more detail. And then, of course, also on top of that, it's really excellent what you have within the framework, which is, I mean, information on SDGs, green, etc. So, I mean, it's. But I think the level of detail would be have to be a bit more. It would be have to be a bit more level of detail to be able to reflect it in the budget.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. If I can move to John Mason, please.
Thanks so much, Convener. Maybe this term, the spending review that we are using, and you've said it's a little bit different from other countries, I just wonder if we're comparing like with like. Because from what I can see, a spending review for us means a few years, it's the overall budget looking at the big picture. Whereas I think one of the examples given was in Germany, they'd had a spending review on transport, or in fact, one part of transport. So it seemed to be a much more specific area, just one area that they were looking at, but looking at it in a lot more detail. And as you said, you know, seeing whether the spending is being useful or not. So are we really comparing like with like when we use this term spending review?
No, I think you're, I mean, yes, you are correct what you say. You're not, I mean, what we are saying, like the UK, and I think like when you Google spending reviews, I mean, the first thing that comes up is, of course, the framework in the UK. That's, I mean, they use it. That I would say, no, you're talking about the budget setting process. I mean, basically, you're just setting the budget and then you think you talk about spending reviews. So it's definitely not, it's correct what you note. But what we, when we hear the word spending reviews, I mean, we think about analyzing existing expenditure, having like it can be comprehensive, and you can analyze. I mean, you can have a government coming in, and they can decide we need to, you know, get 20% spending cuts or something. And in order to do that, we need to analyze transport, health, education. I don't know, just whatever areas that you need. And that's, as you say, as you note with Germany, it's more targeted, so to say. So what I was trying to say earlier was that, I mean, I think the UK and Scotland could have both processes in place. I mean, you could also implement this more targeted spending reviews that other countries are using on top of what you basically call a spending reviews, what we would call the budget setting process.
Yes, I think that makes a lot of sense because I think I kind of feel, my feeling is that we do need both. And I'm not sure if someone's screen has frozen, but anyway, I'll keep talking. I mean, for example, if we take health, which is our largest area of expenditure, you know, I think we know that we're spending too much on reactive health spending like hospitals and not enough on community spending. Like general practitioners and other community health. But, you know, the challenge we find is how to kind of switch from one to the other. And, you know, I don't know if you think your kind of, or other countries' kind of spending review would help us if we were to somehow do that better.
I definitely think that it could be useful for you to have in place this kind of, as you say, I mean, that's at least a way to be able to analyze the important, the big spending areas in a way that you would really target something specific within that area. And that's what we see in countries that they are doing. And I mean, you could find ways to find savings and reallocate the savings to other spending areas or whatever would be the decision of the government in place. But I think, I mean, governments have no way of, like, we know how the budget process works. You're always just focusing on the margin. You're just focusing on the additional money that's needed to tackle some issues that spending entities have. And you're never focusing on the entirety of the spending that is in place. So, I mean, spending reviews in that way allow governments to do that. So I would definitely encourage Scotland to look into ways to implement this kind of a process to the country. I mean, because I think it's really the only tool that that governments have, as I said, to analyze existing expenditure. And definitely there is always room to find some savings within the system.
And could you give us any examples of countries where, you know, that kind of review has led to quite major changes in the way they do things? I mean, I'm particularly interested in what we call preventative spending, that we spend more to prevent things happening, be that health or crime or anything. But we've struggled, and I think other countries have struggled as well, to disinvest from the kind of secondary expenditure.
So, I mean, the prevention is, it's a really interesting point. I mean, because you have, I mean, you were saying that you would want to tackle a certain spending area, and you would want to analyze the need to spend something more on that.
Yes, I think most of us across the political parties in Scotland, most of us agree that we should spend more on preventative spending and less on reactive. But we just, because we're already putting the money into hospitals and prisons, we find it difficult to change that.
Yeah, okay, exactly. No, yeah. So, I mean, yes, that's a really, I mean, you want to be proactive instead of reactive. And I think that's the nature of most budget processes in most OECD countries. You're constantly in reaction mode. You're just reacting to crisis all the time, and you don't get the chance to really analyze where the need is. And I think, yes, I mean, we have some examples, and we'd be happy to send you some more details after this meeting. But I mean, Canada is one country that's done this. I mean, they've been actively using spending review specifically. I mean, it was specifically done after the 2008 crisis to really analyze in detail spending and be able to be, I mean, spending reviews is basically a tool to be able to be proactive. I mean, you analyze spending areas and you see, okay, there's not the need anymore for money in this spending area, but there's more need in this area, so we can move around. I mean, we have plenty of examples. Canada, we have the Scandinavian, I mean, Norway, Denmark has been extremely good with doing this. Ireland was quite active after the crisis. They are using spending reviews in a different way now, but actively analyzing spending areas. Yeah, there are many countries that have good processes in place to do this. Unfortunately, what we see also is that, I mean, spending reviews, they come with crisis, and then they kind of fade away when you don't have a crisis situation. Well, they don't fade away, but they have a different purpose. Then you're more kind of like looking into effectiveness and value for money, kind of like instead of just being also proactive when there's not a time of crisis. Because that's kind of when government just thinks that they have endless amount of money and they can just spend on whatever, as we were talking about earlier. So, I mean, yeah. But this is what we see in countries. And as I said, we'd be happy to send you more details on those countries if needed.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. To move on to COVID more specifically, the Scottish government's intention was that they would have a COVID recovery strategy, which would end this coming summer in 2023. I was just wondering what your opinion was on that. Is that too soon? Should we be looking at COVID recovery lasting longer? Or do we just kind of put that aside and just more deal with general problems from here on?
I would say that it's a bit soon, but I mean, that's just kind of my gut feeling. I mean, we haven't been able to analyze it in detail, but I think in order to be able to learn from the pandemic, and I mean, maybe the smartest thing to do now is to shift a bit, like, you know, instead of, I mean, how can you learn from the pandemic? How can we react? I mean, because we're definitely still, countries are still trying to get out of the pandemic. So, I mean, that's, at least when we were analyzing this recovery strategy this week, I mean, I think it would be good to have it a bit longer. But as I said, I mean, we don't have, it's just something that we see as kind of like what we would in compared to other countries, and just learning a bit more from the pandemic and having some lessons, clear lessons out of the pandemic to prevent this from happening again.
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks, Kavina.
Thank you. Can we move to Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Kavira. Good morning. Thank you for your evidence. I'm actually going to just follow on from my colleague's line of questioning there. We understand the cost the frontline cost of dealing with COVID. We know what the investment was in that. I'm interested in dealing with the fallout from COVID and the spending required in the fallout from COVID. And one of the things we do know is that the cost of COVID was higher because of our poor health report card. A lot of people who suffered from COVID and tragically lost their lives were also tied in with things like obesity and type 2 diabetes and heart conditions. But in dealing with COVID, one of the things we had to do was drop focus on other conditions. So looking forward, those conditions like long COVID, like non-COVID related conditions but were affected by COVID restrictions, like cancers and elective surgery and mental health, you know, obesity and physical fitness, across the OECD countries, where is the priority here? Are we going back and looking at those conditions again and having to reinvest, or are we reinvesting back into those kind of conditions and how we deal with those, the fallout?
I think like many OECD countries after the COVID pandemic, hopefully after, are thinking about, like, as you mentioned, like the mental health issues. I mean, that's of course a big issue in many countries. I think the problem here is that, as we talked about earlier, that countries haven't really been able to take stock and stop and just think about what needs to be done to tackle those issues that have been the results of COVID, the pandemic, because of the a crisis on top of crisis. So I think, like, you know, governments are just generally in reaction mode at the moment, and it's been difficult to tackle those issues. So I think that's the general feeling we have with countries. With the energy crisis and everything, it's just been really difficult for countries to focus on those issues, unfortunately.
But given that response here, in terms of looking ahead, you know, this planning for the next pandemic, you're saying we're reactive. Governments are really looking at what's in front of their face right now rather than looking down the line. So that whole preventative agenda really has been, you know, parked for the greater, thinking about that. Is that something you would agree with? And is that something we need to try and lift our heads and look further down the track?
Yes, definitely. I mean, I think like 2022 was kind of like reaction mode, like countries were just like, you know, trying to figure out how to deal with the crisis on top of the crisis. And of course, we are hoping that now this year, countries will take stock and a bit think about how you can learn from the pandemic. And as we were talking about spending reviews, also thinking about like digging a bit deeper and be able to be proactive instead of reactive, as we were talking about. But I think like you are like it's not been parked. Yeah, maybe it's been parked for a bit, but I just don't think that the most governments have had to deal with such big issues that, I mean, and I'm not saying that the others are not big issues, they definitely are, that they really haven't been able to tackle how to prevent and learn from the pandemic. And I mean, I don't know if you feel the same in Scotland, but this is just the general feeling that we have. There's definitely willingness within OECD governments to learn and do better if something like this is to happen again. But there's just not been the scope in most countries, unfortunately.
I think that my last question on this would be around collection of data. And are we collecting the right data to be able to detail not just the impact of COVID in terms of the population, but the impact of COVID on non-COVID related conditions? And are we able to disaggregate that kind of data just now to be able to plan ahead?
I think this question is exactly the center of what needs to be tackled, the data issue. I mean, my feeling is that no, we don't have the data. I mean, not on this specific issue that you were mentioning, but this is really the important thing to have. I mean, this is what countries need to now focus on. And talking about data, I mean, many countries are just in general struggling with access to data, how you gather data, how do you use data within the budget process, as we were talking about with the performance budgeting framework you have in place. I mean, how do you reflect the correct data? Do you have the sufficient IT structure to be able to create dashboards and have it kind of user-friendly? So, I mean, yes, I think this is definitely a big issue and something that needs to be tackled to gather the correct data and having this data to be able to analyse and learn from the crisis.
I'm good with that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I bring in Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you very much, convener. I've got to say, I'm listening to all of the answers and the questions, and it gives a very kind of splattered picture of where we are, certainly in my mind anyway. So we've got a spending review, which isn't actually a spending review. It's a forward planning, but we're not actually looking back to see have we spent that money wisely. I'm sorry, you're going to have to bear with me because I'm trying to piece all this together as I'm going along. Relating back to Murdo Fraser's questions, the 2008, you talked about the fiscal consolidating that was done in 2008, and then in COVID, we've just spent money regardless, it was just paid for. But there were lessons learned from the 2008 crisis. Taking, and I know that's quite a big ask, but taking the war in Ukraine out of it because of the energy situation that gave us, could the current cost of living crisis, although it's been exacerbated, could it have been predicted from the lessons of 2008 by knowing that this massive spend that was happening during COVID, plus the stopping of economies from working, as we were like putting a dam in water. Once you lift the dam, the water flushes. What's the effects going to be? Could we have better predicted the cost of living crisis that we're in because of what we were racking up during COVID?
Yeah, I think we could have definitely told ourselves that this would happen regardless of what's happening in Ukraine, definitely. It was at the moment in COVID that like interest rates were really low in many countries. I mean, you were just like thinking that money was for free. And then, I mean, we know what happens after crisis. We know what happens when governments spend a lot. There is like a day where you have to, you know, there is a payment day that you really have to look into what you've been spending. So definitely, I think everything set aside, yes, this could have been, everyone knew what was about to come. But I mean, I don't know if the reason was that governments just didn't want to tackle that at the moment. There was too much to tackle at the moment. But I think, like, you know, and I think this is just exactly what the economists around the world were saying. I mean, there will be a day where you need to pay back. So, I mean, it's a really good question because, yes, I think, when was it like the first year of the pandemic, just money was flowing everywhere. Governments were just like, you know, putting money. Well, it was not only health, it was like so much bigger than that. So, I mean, and we knew that how central banks were responding to the crisis as well, which was quite different from the 2008 crisis. I mean, so definitely this, everyone should have known that, I mean, we would be in this situation now in 2023. But then on top of that, I don't know if it's a way to just, it's a good shield, so to say. I don't know if that's the thing or if it's just something that, I mean, then other things happened that were, and now it's just more difficult to tackle the crisis. So, I mean, that's kind of my response to that.
Okay, so we've got the kind of feeling that we could have been better planning ahead. And that then takes me on to my further confusion, which there is a lot of through this session, I have to tell you. We've got an excellent performance framework. The missing link is to the budget. There are other countries who do this where they link the two. What other countries do it the way Scotland does, and why is it being done that way as opposed to linking the budget to the performance framework? Not from Scotland's point of view, from other countries that you're dealing with, because I know you haven't had a direct link to Scotland.
We have one example, the Netherlands. They used to have quite a good link to the budget between the performance, the performance framework and the budget documents, but now it's faded away. I don't really know why. Maybe it was just not political will or something. I don't know. Maybe it was too much to have. And I don't know if, Indre, if you have any other examples of countries that are doing it similarly to Scotland.
Right, okay.
I think she's trying to bring in Indra.
So, to just jump in, countries that have like performance frameworks completely separate, I think that countries are actually striving to establish the link with the budget. So the countries that, you know, in the past had it separate, it's likely that now they are trying to find the right link to the budget. For example, there are countries that, like Greece or France, they are really striving to find the right date to decide what data is the right data to put in the budget, how it should be presented, and etc. So I think it's better to look at the countries that managed to establish this link and managed to have decision-making tools and have, so that the information is within the budget. But if you look, for example, in Ireland, your neighbors, basically, they have a lot of performance information in the budget. But what is the right information that is included in the budget is another question. And we always talk with countries that they should be very selective of what information should be in the budget. Because if you just take your framework and include all the information with the budget, it's the question is it usable, and can parliamentarians and your committee, can you make sense of it, you know?
Okay.
And then there is a question of who develops that information. Is it Ministry of Finance, or is it like who are the people that develop that performance information to be included in the budget? We always talk with countries that it should be the spending entities that develop that information. They should have ownership, and that's where accountability angle comes in. So I think I've shifted away from the main question, but let me know if you want to.
What you've actually led me very neatly onto when you're talking about what data is actually there, what the information is there, because Brian has just stated that we've got a bigger cost during COVID because of our particular health challenges. Is that actually correct, that Scotland has had to pay more through COVID because we have particular health challenges in Scotland? Is that correct? Has it cost us more financially than other countries because of Scotland's health challenges? That's the question I'm asking.
So you would say, has the health cost been higher in Scotland because of the previous challenges within the healthcare system?
Yes.
No, I would say no. You're facing exactly the same challenges as most other countries.
Okay.
I mean, the problem area is health spending in most countries, so yeah.
Okay. Right, have I got time? If we're talking about how we're looking forward to another pandemic, okay, so we want to plan for another pandemic, we want to tackle the current health problems that we have, but we also want to put money into preventative spending. If I was a finance minister looking at that right now, I'd be saying I'm going to have to quadruple my budget in order to make all of these things happen. How does a government take all of this data, all of this information, and all of these challenges and make it fit? How do you do that? It's not a trick question, it's genuinely.
So if you were a finance minister, I mean, I think if I was a finance minister, wouldn't we just say to other ministers, I mean, isn't there any way to find some savings within all the, you know, all the money you have in place? I mean, do you really, is the need of this, or that's also linked to, I mean, the importance of data. The needs of citizens, are they the same as they were in, I don't know, 1990 or something? Like with the what's been happening in many areas? I mean, because as I said, like what goes into the budget really goes out of the budget. So if you really look into the budget in Scotland and in any other country, I think there is quite a lot of room to make some spending cuts within. So, I mean, I think a finance minister would rather ask the question, can we find some informed spending cuts? And that's where spending reviews, they come in handy, because across the board spending cuts, I mean, you never get to analyze, and you just like where really you can make the savings. So, I mean, I think that's the question I would at least ask, if I know it's easier said than done. But to ask that question, I think we can all find some savings within our envelopes.
So that's a really interesting point you just made. What goes into a budget never, ever comes out again. So once it's tied in, it's baked into the future spending so that that money is never lost. But, and this is anecdotal, from a local authority point of view, it's one of these things where they will spend money at the end of a financial term in order to get rid of it so they don't lose it out of the budget. So if we've got spending reviews which are actually forward spending reviews, what you're saying is we could help to tackle those issues by having previous spending reviews to look at how the money was spent and did it give us value for money. Is that what you're saying? In very simplistic terms.
Yes, I mean, definitely. That's one way of saying it. I mean, you can look at how spending has been performing over time. That's one way of using spending reviews in that way. I mean, as you say, like the December fever, you know, every kind of spending entity is like, you know, we have to spend everything so the Ministry of Finance doesn't think that we don't need the money next year. I mean, there are no incentives. And I think that's another thing that's really important to have in place. I mean, some incentives for underspending. I mean, what do you like, you know, how can you really bring that to the table? And that's one thing that actually we learned from the 2008 crisis is that countries try to implement new frameworks around budgeting, where actually they were kind of like trying to put in place some incentives for more accountability of spending entities, incentives to really save, etc. But this is really the problem because, like, you know, you just focus on the margin. You always think like, I need more, and you never think about how am I spending all the money that you have in place.
Yeah. Hugh Leinderson, thank you very much.
Thank you. That brings us to a close. I thank Alfred and Indra for your evidence and giving us your time this morning. If you'd like to raise any further evidence with the committee, you can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you on how to do this. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow a change over of witnesses. Thank you. I'm ready to go. I'll now turn to agenda item number 2. Under this agenda item, we'll take evidence from the Scottish Government on the Scottish Government's budget for 2023 to 2024. And I'd like to welcome to the meeting John Swinney, the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Simon Mair, Deputy Director of COVID Recovery and Public Service Reform, Christine McLaughlin, Director of Population Health, and Jamie McDougall, Deputy Director for Budget and Public Spending. Welcome and thank you for your attendance this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move on to questions?
I'll make some brief opening remarks. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters relating to the impact of the 2023-24 budget with regard to the Scottish Government's COVID recovery strategy and the COVID-19 strategic framework, and any other issues, of course, on the minds of the committee. The Scottish Government's 23-24 budget took place in the most turbulent economic and fiscal context most people can remember. The impacts of the pandemic, coupled with Russia's continued illegal invasion of Ukraine, have created a disruptive set of financial and economic challenges that every government must address. Energy and fuel prices are surging and inflation has reached a 40-year high. Further, the UK Government is responsible for additional uncertainty and instability. Brexit has impacted our labour supply and undermined trade with our nearest neighbours. These are incredibly difficult times in which to manage public finances, and the constraints of devolution mean the Scottish Government cannot borrow to meet additional costs that arise during the financial year. Within this challenging context, the 23-24 budget focuses on reducing child poverty, supporting a just transition to a net zero economy, and delivering fiscally sustainable person-centred public services. These priorities are aligned with the principles of the Scottish Government's COVID recovery strategy, which focuses on addressing systemic inequalities and supporting those most disproportionately affected during the pandemic. Since the COVID recovery strategy was published, the worsening cost crisis has made it even more critical for the Scottish Government to focus its efforts on supporting those most in need. The Government has consistently taken decisive action to prioritise spending where it is most needed, including in the emergency budget review. The 23-24 budget demonstrates the Scottish Government's continued commitment to prioritising those who most need support. For example, we're extending and increasing the Scottish Child Payment to £25 per week, uprating all devolved benefits by 10.1%, widening the Warmer Homes Fuel Poverty Programme, and freezing rail fares until at least March 2023. In total, the Scottish Government has allocated around £3 billion this financial year to contribute towards mitigating the increased cost crisis. Over £1 billion of this support is only available in Scotland, with the remainder being more generous than that provided elsewhere in the UK. With regard to the ongoing response to COVID-19, the Scottish Government published a revised strategic framework in February 2022, which set out a long-term approach to managing COVID and its associated harms. The Scottish Government remains alert to the threat posed by potential new variants of COVID-19, and I welcome the National Respiratory Surveillance and Variants and Mutations plans that have been published by Public Health Scotland, which set out the processes that will be undertaken to identify and assess any future risk. We are supporting these plans with direct investment of approximately £7.4 million and £3 million respectively, with up to a further £3 million available for wastewater surveillance. The Scottish Government continues to work with partners and is ready to respond to any increase in the threat posed by the virus, whether that comes from waning immunity, a new variant or other factors. In any future response, we will apply careful judgment to ensure that responses are appropriately targeted and the necessary resources prioritised. I included further details of funding arrangements for ongoing pandemic response in my recent letter to the committee. I will continue to keep the committee updated on in-year changes to the Scottish budget through corporate reporting and in-year budget revisions. I'm very happy to answer questions the committee may have.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I think we all appreciate how challenging circumstances are at the moment for the government. If I can turn to questions and begin with the first question. Latest data estimates 1 in 25 people in Scotland currently have COVID, and I know we're in a much better place than we were back in 2020 due to the vaccinations. But sadly, in Scotland in 2022, we lost 2,864 people to COVID, and 81 people have lost their lives so far. And our thoughts go out to every family, but behind these stats, it's a stark reality that COVID is still a threat. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister for an update on the Scottish Government's plans for the next round of booster vaccinations, including the predicted timing, targeted groups and estimated funding requirements?
The, first of all, Kavira, the data that you record there is very sobering data about the loss of life in relation to COVID, and it does demonstrate the importance of taking all necessary measures to protect the population against COVID that are appropriate in the context. And obviously, the commitment that the government has given to the vaccination programme has been a significant protection for wider population health in relation to COVID. When we look at the vaccination programme, essentially, is set out and targeted at a range of particular groups identified by the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation. So the Scottish Government continues to do what it has always done, which is to follow the clinical advice given to us by the JCVI. The programme of COVID vaccinations are available to a wide variety of groups, older adults in care homes, people who are aged over 50, frontline health and social care workers, and those in the 5 to 64 age group who are at risk from COVID. So the vaccination programme is targeted towards those individuals. Obviously, we have a variation in uptake at different groupings. For example, in the older adults in care homes, the uptake in Scotland is 89.3%. Amongst the over 65s, it's at 90%. Aged 50 to 64, it's at 64.3%. The frontline health and social care workers, it varies around about sort of low 50%. So there's a variety of different, but these are generally pretty high levels of uptake of vaccination that that we have available. In relation to cost, convener, the expected expenditure on vaccinations in this current financial year is expected to be around about £170 million. That's not including the cost of the vaccinations themselves. That is what those costs are dealt with as part of the Four Nations programme. If we were to opt out of that programme, we would be likely to get a consequential, but you know, for reasons of efficiency and procurement, and we've habitually taken part in a Four Nations programme on flu vaccinations, for example. So that's the essentially the cost of the delivery of that programme within Scotland, and we anticipate and are planning on a relatively similar amount in the 23-24 forecasts. And I think the final point I would make, convener, is that in relation to the advice from the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation, we have followed that this year. We would expect to follow that next year and to fund it accordingly. And we, of course, await any further advice from the JCVI about their view about what is the appropriate steps to take for a vaccination programme for the next year. We anticipate the current programme to end at the end of March.
Thank you. That's helpful, that update. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister to provide an update on the news reports that the ONS coronavirus COVID-19 infection survey for Scotland could be shut down in the spring, and what implications that will have on monitoring COVID and also the recovery from COVID?
I'll maybe invite Christine McLaughlin to perhaps provide some information on that. But I think what I'd want to, the one point I would want to make to the committee is the government, the nature of where we are with COVID now is that we have a significant amount of population health protection as a consequence of the effectiveness of the vaccination programme. Therefore, the necessity to have in place the scale of arrangements that we had in place during the height of the pandemic are unlikely to be the case, even if we have a new variant of COVID, because the level of population protection is so high because of the vaccination programme. Having said that, it is, however, important that we have effective surveillance and monitoring arrangements in place to ensure that we can accurately predict whether we have a wider problem that has to be arrested. And, of course, some of the information I placed on the record in my opening statement sets out the type of societal assessment that we are undertaking routinely to ensure that we have those preparatory arrangements in place. But I'll invite Christine McLaughlin to say some things about the ONS survey.
Thanks, Convener. The discussions are still ongoing across the four nations because the ONS study has been, as you'll know, the strength of it has been a four nations consistent approach. So no decision as yet that I'm aware of has been taken on that, but certainly it's part of the considerations for the right scope and shape of the surveillance programme going into next year. But I think what I would say is the ONS study has been world-leading, and it's been very useful to have that data, but it is one of several sources of data that we have. I think you had Public Health Scotland before talking to you about, in particular, the surveillance approach that we've got. So we've invested in some new areas of surveillance that we didn't have in place before, or not at that extent. So things like the community surveillance programme, where there's a rolling programme of tests within community settings. Similarly, within acute hospital settings, there's samples taken every week and tested and sequenced. So they are also part of that surveillance that we have. Wastewater testing, again, is technology that you'll know that we didn't have before and has been so successful that not only are we looking to maintain it, but we're looking at other uses for wastewater testing, testing for polio being one that we've put in place recently. We can now even sequence wastewater samples. So that's a technology that I think that certainly our public health teams are see as really valuable going forward. We've also got the SIREN study, which is routine testing that healthcare workers voluntarily take part in. So for us, surveillance is all of those things taken together. And the ONS study, as I say, has been a very unique component of that. It's also a very expensive part of the surveillance when you compare it to things like the community and the hospital surveillance. So it just needs to be looked at in the round. But I say the strength, I think, has been that it's been consistent across the four nations, so you can see what's happening and you can understand data into regional components. But we never look at ONS on its own. We always look at it with the other sources of data to see whether they're all saying the same thing. So if the ONS study wasn't to continue either at the same scale or we didn't take it forward in a four nation basis, then we have already been working through with our Public Health Scotland and colleagues about whether we would look to bolster some of the other surveillance that we have in place. I think that the weakness might be that you wouldn't then have consistency across the four nations as we go forward. So very much a live part of our discussions, and we are a partner in that rather than it being a sole Scottish decision at this point in time.
Okay, thank you. I think we've taken evidence on surveillance, so the committee is familiar with that. I'll move on to Meadow Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. Excuse me. I'm interested in exploring a little bit further just how COVID-related measures will be funded in the budget for the coming year. Now, you mentioned, the booster vaccination scheme. We had an exchange in the chamber yesterday about that. You will recall. Is it expected that in the coming year there will be another programme of the booster vaccination scheme? And has funding for that been set aside in the budget for next year for that already? Or are we just waiting to see what happens elsewhere?
We are working on the assumption that there is a further booster programme that will come forward. And as indicated in my earlier answer to the convener, the sums of money that are around about the same level that we've had in the budget for this year is predicted to be deployed in the next financial year to support a booster programme. Now, obviously, if we get advice that says it's not necessary, then obviously that's is not required. But I think a prudent assumption at this stage would be that there will be likely to be a booster programme.
OK, thank you. And if we got to a situation where there was, you know, another variant or, perish the thought, another pandemic that occurred in the coming financial year, and there was a need, therefore, to step in with new interventions, such as bringing back track and trace and so on, is there anything in the budget to fund that, or are you, would you be reliant upon Barnett consequentials from happening, what was happening elsewhere in the UK?
Essentially, we're making provisions in the budget for what I would describe as a baseline level of preparedness for the challenges from COVID. Although I do want to make a distinction in responding to Mr. Fraser's question between a new variant and a new pandemic, because these are two fundamentally different propositions. A new variant, I would be, you know, on the basis of what we know just now and the variants that are taking place, the level of population-wide vaccination protection, we would be fairly confident would enable us to withstand the effects of a new variant, given the level of protection inherent in the vaccination and given the nature of variants that are emerging at this present time. A completely different proposition, or a completely different pandemic, if I use my language more precisely, is a different matter altogether. And that could conceivably require us to put in place the type of arrangements with which we have had to have experience in the course of the last 3 years. And obviously we hope that that is not the case. But in enabling us to be able to respond to all of those scenarios, we have certain provisions in the budget for the surveillance activity that Christine McLaughlin has put on the record to the committee this morning. We have provisions for a level of testing that is in the budget. We have provision for the delivery of a further vaccination programme. And we also have provision for a level of workforce capacity, PPE issues, equipment considerations, and some wider factors that are built into the budget just now. Now, that is funded from the overall budget that's available for the health and social care portfolio, which is in excess of £19 billion. And obviously there is a certain amount of consequential funding from the United Kingdom government that comes generally for health and social care priorities as a consequence of decisions made in the autumn statement and announced by the Chancellor of the Exchequer. But the Scottish government is putting in more than those Barnett consequentials into the health service. It was an explicit part of the budget statement I gave to Parliament in December that I was making tax changes and applying tax increases to enable me to be in a position to better fund the National Health Service, which we have been able to do.
Okay, thank you for that. And this money that's being set aside within the overall health budget, should that money not be then be required, that could then be redeployed elsewhere, could it?
I don't, on the level of provision that we have here, I don't really think that's the case, to be honest. Mm-hmm. The level of PPE preparedness, you know, the committee will be familiar with the importance of the PPE provision in general within all aspects of the health and social care system. So that would be expenditure I would expect to undertake. I can't be certain, but I think it's likely we'll have a booster vaccination programme, so I'd think that money will be spent. And the testing arrangements are a level of preparedness so that we maintain a capacity to undertake testing, to be able to increase testing from where it is just now, but then obviously it creates that creates a platform for us to increase very significantly should be we be required to do so. So I think the best answer I can give is that my expectation would be that this expenditure will be required during the financial year, but of course we undertake regular monitoring, and as the committee will appreciate from the updates I've provided on the wider financial situation, there can be very, very wide variation in demand and pressures on the budget in general for the government over the course of a financial year. So even if we didn't have to spend the money on this, I would imagine there'll be something else will come along that will demand further expenditure.
Okay, thank you. And lastly, Convener, for me, can I ask about the COVID recovery strategy, which is currently due to wind down by the summer of this year? Is that still your intention to wind it down on that timescale?
I think I'm not sure I would express it in the way that Mr. Fraser's expressed it, because and I understand the where he's coming from the 18-month perspective, but the COVID recovery strategy is very much, you know, if one was to look at the themes of the budget that I set out in December and look at the COVID recovery strategy, I think a dispassionate observer would see a very strong link between the themes of the COVID recovery strategy and the themes of the budget. So I suppose what I would say, the way I would probably express it, is the COVID recovery strategy is being mainstreamed within the government's budget and policy programme, so that, for example, the emphasis that we place on the shift to person-centred public services is absolutely central to the budget programme. The emphasis on eradicating child poverty, which is implicit in the COVID recovery strategy, is central to the budget priorities that I set out in December. So I think the best way to express it would be that the strategy is being mainstreamed, and many of the the indicators, the focus of the strategy and the indicators of performance are very much part of the performance framework of the government.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in Jackie Bailey, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Deputy First Minister. Can I go back to questioning that Murdo Fraser developed? And you know, I'm very conscious that and I understand the difficulty and the uncertainty in predicting what's going to happen with the pandemic, particularly as new variants are being experienced. But what I see is population testing largely ended. What I also see is the Lighthouse Labs closing. Antiviral medication has been suggested to me not getting to people in time. And so far in Scotland, we're not yet using prophylactics. Now, all of these things will vary depending on, you know, the prevalence of COVID at any one time. So what I want to do is explore what is that flexibility, that surge capacity beyond what you've said that would allow things to be flexed up really quickly. And I'm also wondering, in response to Murdo, you talked about additional funding for the health budget, but I'm wondering, are these measures covered by existing COVID consequentials, or have you had to add to them?
Let me try to deal with quite a number of the issues in there. First of all, just as an observation, Jackie Bailey set out her personal experience of antivirals. I have some personal experience of antiviral distribution, and I cannot compliment the health service and the arrangements more for the experience that my family had of the availability of antiviral drugs, which stunned me, frankly, about the efficiency of the delivery and, frankly, the impact of the antivirals, for which we were certainly profoundly grateful in our household. On the flex capacity, this is, of course, a very careful judgment to be made here. And what I would like to reassure the committee about this morning is that the government's strategic approach and our budget provisions are designed to create an appropriate platform from which we could increase provision. So it's not it's a higher level of preparedness than was there, that would have been there, you know, prior to the intelligence on COVID.
That was quite a low bar, though.
But it's an appropriate platform that is available. So Christine McLaughlin has gone through the information on wider population surveillance, which is developed technologically in a very short space of time, remarkably, and provides us with a very significant level of intelligence that can be established. And obviously we are monitoring that information carefully to see any signs of development and deviance of performance which raises concerns. We obviously are plugged into international networks on new variants and are monitoring those very carefully. There is then a level of testing capacity which is, we've maintained the laboratory at Gartnavel, which has the capacity to process, as things stand just now, 60,000 tests a day. So that's a formidable level of testing capacity. And we also have 60,000 a week, my apologies. And then there's also the regional PCR testing arrangements that we have in different parts of the country. We have stocks of lateral flow devices that can be deployed for should there be the emergence of a new variant, and obviously the new variant plans that can be brought forward should they be required. And then of course we are following closely the thinking and the expertise of the Pandemic Preparedness Committee that is led by Professor Andrew Morris, who I think has given evidence to the committee to ensure that we are maintaining an approach which is appropriate with to that level. And as I said in my answer to Mr Fraser, there is a variety of other investments that are being made routinely within the budget programme on PPE and other factors. Lastly, on the question of consequentials, this is a difficult question to be precise about. So, essentially, if we look at the statement given by the Chancellor of the Exchequer in November, arising out of that was, if my memory serves me right, a consequential for health and social care of some, I think it was about £300 million of that order. Mm-hmm. I think it's between £200 and £300 million. It was, we've added to that to uplift the budget by about £1 billion. Now, as Jackie Bailey knows, the UK consequentials don't come with a badge on them, other than a badge of health, and we've generally taken the consequentials on health and put them into health and social care. They don't come with a badge saying COVID consequentials or whatever the uplift is in the UK. In the English departments, gives rise to a COVID consequential into the Scottish Government. So we've increased that by the contributions that we've made.
Okay. Could I ask about long COVID?
Could I just...
Sorry, of course.
Just one final point. I should say, in relation to vaccine, the actual costs of the vaccine... Yes. That's handled by a Four Nations agreement with the UK government, handled out with all the sums of money I've talked about there. Now, in theory, if we were to say we're not part of a Four Nations arrangement, we would get a consequential for that. But I think, on a whole variety of different vaccination programmes, we've generally worked on, whether it's flu or COVID, we've generally taken the view of the logistical and procurement advantages of being in a four nations arrangement.
No, I understood that from your previous response, but that's helpful clarification. Long COVID, I think we would agree, is a considerable challenge, not just in health terms, but actually in economic terms. And the number of economically inactive people has increased substantially as a consequence. There was 3 million announced this year for NHS services to help with this. That's when there were 77,000 people affected. There are now 180,000 people affected. Given that this isn't just a health intervention, but it's an economic one, what plans are there to perhaps increase the amount that is available for the treatment of long COVID?
I agree about the importance of long COVID and ensuring that individuals who experience long COVID are supported in their recovery. I would challenge Jackie Bailey on the point about a significant increase in economic inactivity, because that's not what the data says. The data shows, the data was published just on Tuesday, that economic inactivity in Scotland has actually reduced by 0.8% over the course of the year. And that's actually a larger fall in Scotland than in the rest of the United Kingdom. Now, I appreciate within that there will be ebbs and flows. There will be people who are become economically inactive because of long COVID. But just for the accuracy of the data the committee has before it, that is the position on economic inactivity. Now, I think there's obviously been a significant amount of discussion about what is the appropriate means to address the experience of long COVID that individuals have. And fundamentally, there will be a need for health interventions to support individuals to do exactly that. And it's very difficult to disaggregate what is being spent within the health service on supporting people with long COVID, because that will be felt in a whole variety of different areas, whether it's in the services of in community settings, in the work of general practitioners, or in more specialist clinics where people will be having support to provide them in addressing the experiences that they have. So there will be a need for the health budget. As I've said, the health budget has been increased by £1 billion over £1 billion in the course of the year to provide the capacity to enable us to meet the health needs of the population, which will of course include people who are who have experience of long COVID. And it's important that individuals who have that experience are supported in the appropriate way.
Final question, convener, but can I just clarify?
Jackie, can I move on to John Mason? We will come back to you if we can get... Sorry.
No problem.
We're just short of time, John Mason.
Thanks very much, convener. Deputy First Minister, you answered the convener earlier about vaccinations for this coming year or how they're currently going. And, I mean, the figures for over 65s and older adults in care homes seem very good. Some of the care workers' figures don't seem quite as strong. I think you said, around or below 50%. Specified frontline social care workers, 39.8%. It seems quite low. Do you have an explanation for that?
I think I can't give a definitive explanation to Mr. Mason, but for example, in frontline social care workers, the uptake rate is 63.2%. There's other categories that give a slightly lower figure that's involved. I think a lot of this can be to do with convenience and access to services. Some of it, I think, can be to do with the fact that people performing these roles might have to take time to go to do this when they will be under pressure to fulfil their social care tasks. And that's obviously quite a conundrum for individuals. And these are people who are on low pay, and therefore they have got difficult dilemmas about how they spend their time, whether it's spending
time... You don't think there's an active kind of resistance to them, or, you know, the misinformation which continues to come to me in social media, that's not having an impact, do you think?
I don't think so. My sense would be that the numbers are increasing week by week, so we're not at the end of the programme. We're in January. We've still got, best part of 2.5 months. We're trying to make it as easy as possible for people to access these opportunities. The clinics are widely available across the geography of the country. But I do accept for people in a low-income situation who might have to travel somewhere else, which might involve the cost to travel, it is a thought to do that. Quite a difficult thought, which is why we're trying to take all the practical steps we can to support people in those circumstances.
Okay, thank you. When the committee wrote to you, you replied on the 20th of December in your letter and an annex with the questions. And the first question was about COVID recovery and the cost crisis. And specifically, the committee had been asking about whether the inflationary pressures, the cost crisis, are negatively impacting on the COVID recovery strategy. And we got a page of an answer, but I wasn't still very clear having read it. So can I press you on that point? Is the inflationary pressures impacting on the COVID recovery strategy?
I'll sharpen up my language then for Mr. Mason, because my long and detailed text is designed to say yes, of course, the inflationary pressures are putting enormous pressure on the government's budget in general, and will inevitably put pressure on the COVID recovery strategy. Mr. Mason, from his membership of the Finance Committee and his assiduous following of financial matters in the Parliament, will be pretty familiar, I think, with my current worry list. Top of my worry list is the fact that because of the fact that there has been no restatement of the budget available to the Scottish Government during 22-23, given there has been no additional consequential funding since the start of 22-23 to deal with inflation, which was, the budget was set when inflation was expected to be 2%. Inflation is at 10.5% yesterday. So there's been no consequential funding to assist us. So therefore the government and the government has had to wrestle with legitimate pay claims from public sector workers. So as a consequence, I've had to take some very difficult decisions to reduce public expenditure to try to balance the government's budget. At the same time, I have made provision for the government to increase the value of the Scottish Child Payment to £25 a week, which is a direct investment to support families struggling in the cost crisis, which I know will be of benefit to many of Mr. Mason's constituents. And after all that, Mr. Mason will be familiar with the fact that I'm still wrestling with a predicted overspend on the government's resource budget in this financial year of between £200 and £500 million, which is unprecedented for a finance minister to be wrestling with a problem of that magnitude so late in the financial year.
Absolutely, I completely agree with that. So is there anything specific in the COVID recovery strategy that you would say has suffered because of all of this?
I think the pace of development is perhaps a challenge there, although I would counter that by saying that the fact that we avoided local authority industrial action significantly across the country helped to maintain the impetus around about the delivery of the COVID recovery strategy. The fact that we've avoided industrial action in the health service so far is, I think, a welcome consequence of the government taking on the additional financial strain of wrestling with the public sector pay claims that we have satisfactorily addressed.
Well, on that point then, I mean, the suggestion had previously had been that the public sector staff numbers as a whole would go back to pre-COVID levels. Has that commitment been affected by the pay increases and so on?
know that will, we will have to work carefully with trade unions and staff associations over the course of the four-year profile of the spending period we have available to reduce staff numbers. We face a situation where the profile of the four-year spending envelope that's available to us would be generally characterised as less challenging in the first 2 years, extremely challenging in the last 2 years. These are the provisions of the current United Kingdom government. The opposition have in the United Kingdom Parliament have made it clear that they will sustain these numbers should the election result in a change of government. So I think we have to prepare on the basis that we will have to, in dialogue, in partnership with trade unions and staff associations, carefully reduce headcount over the course of the next 4 years.
Okay, thanks. And on a slightly different issue, we just had a session with the OECD. I don't know if you were able to see any of that because you obviously came in straight after that. And I mean, there was quite an interesting discussion around spending reviews. I think we kind of established that their definition of a spending review is slightly different from our definition of a spending review. Their definition, I think, is more that other countries look at a specific area, and one was Germany. They looked at transport and had a spending review of transport and really looked in depth at what they were already spending and to see if they could make savings and move forward. And I was asking them, well, do you think that's something we could do, say, with the health service, to say, well, we're spending all this on reactive spending. We'd like to move more into preventative kind of primary care. Is that something we could kind of learn from? And I think the feeling overall was that maybe we could learn from other countries. Do you think there's anything in that space? I realise that's kind of a new topic, but do you think we can do anything about examining present expenditure to see if we can free up more, or are we already doing that?
I feel as if I'm living in a perpetual spending review, to be honest, because all of those elements of challenge that Mr. Mason has put to me, we are wrestling with on a constant basis. So when I talk about the public service reform agenda, which I spoke of extensively in the budget statement in December, that is us actively challenging the way in which public bodies are operating with the objective of delivering greater efficiency. Now, at other committees of Parliament, I was at the Economy Committee yesterday, and I was being challenged on some of the spending envelopes that are available to enterprise agencies, for example. Those spending envelopes, of their own volition, essentially challenge the existing way of working. They require savings to be made to ensure organisations can live within those spending envelopes. In the health service, the pressure of demand, increased pressure from pay settlements, force a requirement to constantly review the efficiency and challenge the efficiency of how we operate. But there's also a fundamental other element of thinking, which is the work that is going on a continuous basis to essentially deliver, for example, the Christie principles, which Mr. Mason will be very familiar with, which essentially operate on a presumption of the earlier we can make an intervention, the better it can be, and the more that will help us to avoid acute interventions, because acute interventions, however we badge them, are expensive.
I think it would be fair to say we've struggled with that, haven't we?
No, I don't think we have struggled with it. I think a lot of reform has actually been undertaken, which I don't think... I think there's a bit of a kind of commentary. Now, I look at all these magazine articles about the Christie Commission and all the rest of it, and I think, well, I don't actually think people have been looking that closely at what's actually been going on within public services and the focus on early intervention and the steps that are made within our education system on early intervention, or the steps made in our health service on early intervention. Now, is there more that could be done? Of course there is. But I do think a lot has been achieved. But essentially what we are trying to do is to avoid crisis and acute interventions, because the more of them we have, the more difficult the challenges that we face. Now, if we were to look at a lot of the evidence that is being presented just now about presentations at accident and emergency in Scotland, a lot of the evidence indicates that the people who are arriving at accident and emergency are much more ill, much more frail than would have been the case in the past. Now that's, I think, a combination of the extension of longevity in our society, some of the ability to support people at home in the fashion that we have been able to do so, and actually the success of some of the preventative and early intervention. But if we have a population that has got, and I'll try to word this as carefully as I can, more older people in it than it used to have, then inevitably the pressures of frailty and old age will be more acutely felt within our health service than was the case in the past.
Okay, I mean, I can probably explore this.
And that's why I say demand requires efficiency within the health service.
Okay, thanks so much.
I'll move on to Brian Whittle, but I will try and get background to members. Brian?
Let's explore that, welcome, Cabinet Secretary. In terms of COVID recovery, we know the cost. We know the cost of having dealt with COVID previously, and you've indicated to other members that, looking ahead, there is a budget there that assumes that there will be further COVID spending done. But in terms of dealing with the fallout of COVID, there's obviously a cost associated with other conditions that were affected by the COVID restrictions. I mean, we know, cancers and elective surgery and mental health and obesity and physical fitness, etc. We know this to be true, which is why I was really interested in your last answer. Given that, in terms of COVID recovery, is the budget going to reflect our ability to deal with that fallout from COVID? Because it is inevitably going to turn up somewhere in the ledger.
I think that the budget, in my opinion, provides the appropriate resources in a variety of different areas of policy to assist COVID recovery, because COVID recovery is about not just within the health service, it will apply within the education system, it will apply within the justice system. We've got people who are waiting for court cases to be resolved, which have been delayed because of COVID, and I've got to make sure that the burden of a victim is lifted by having these cases resolved. So I have to allocate resources to a wide variety of areas, and I've endeavoured to do that right across the government's budget. But there is a finite sum of money available. I've chosen to expand the amount of money that's available by increasing tax on higher income earners. Now, I know that's not supported by Mr Whittle's party, but I've made that choice to make sure there's more resources available, to maximise the resources that are available to invest in public services. So, yes, I think that will be the case, but I also have to be candid with the committee that it will take us some time to recover from COVID, because it has been a very significant and disruptive force within our public services and our society.
Thank you. We await with interest to see whether raising of taxes actually puts any more money into the budget. But I mean,
I think I can confidently say it'll do that.
I've heard that confidence before, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I can demonstrate it without turn data, which gives me confidence about the future data.
Can I go back to my original question around the treatment of the funding of non-COVID related conditions as recovering from COVID? Because we know from data that in those most affected with COVID and those with the worst outcomes had other health conditions attached to them, you know, obesity and type 2 diabetes and heart conditions and many other conditions like that. So looking ahead and discussing the preventative agenda and prepping for future pandemics, which given when we talk to the OECD, not just this, all governments are really dealing with what's right in front of them at the moment, and it can be difficult to look further ahead. But given what we know, the impact that COVID had on outcomes of those with other conditions, wouldn't it be prudent to start looking at how we tackle our poor health record in Scotland? It's a subject I know that the Cabinet Secretary knows that I'm very interested in. Wouldn't it be prudent for us to start at least looking at how we can tackle that poor health record in terms of future pandemics?
Well, I think I'd want to assure Mr. Whittle that we are constantly looking at how we can improve the health of the population proactively and in that approach of early intervention. And there are so many different ways in which we're trying to do that through the encouragement of people to carefully manage and prepare themselves and their health, to exercise, to take all the necessary precautions they can to maintain their physical fitness and their general health and well-being. And across government, there'll be a range of different areas of activity taken forward. Across local government, in the third sector, there'll be a whole range of different interventions. So I think the topic that Mr. Whittle raises with me is certainly a very important issue. I don't think it's just actually pandemic related. It's a point in in general that we should be attentive to and focused on how we improve the health and well-being of the population. And so many of the public messages of the government, so many of our policy interventions, whether it's on minimum unit pricing of alcohol or the banning of smoking in public places or the exhortation to exercise, the daily mile, all these different type of things are all part of that agenda. And and I'm also not going to sit here and say that there aren't more things that we could do. And I'm certainly, the government's very open to dialogue with colleagues in Parliament about how we can maximise that work.
I think we agree on the outcomes we want to happen here. I think that what's important is outcomes, and currently, we have a poor health report card compared to many countries in Europe, and it's before COVID, this is a topic that I'm really exercised with. And as you said, Cabinet Secretary, and what I agree with, a lot of the health outcomes and positive health outcomes will be tackled out with the health service. But where we currently stand is correct me if I'm wrong, Cabinet Secretary, I'm sure you will, 44% of our budget now is spent on health, and with a reduction, we'll be 27% in local government. But a lot of the interventions that will be required to deal with these issues that are impacted by COVID will be dealt with at local government. So how do you square that circle, Cabinet Secretary?
Well, the local government budget's going up by over £550 million. So it's not being cut, it's going up by £550 million.
I said the percentages of budget have moved.
Well, but I'm dealing with cash. And local authorities are getting £550 million more next year than they got this year. So that's whatever way we want to dress it up, that's an increase. So that enables us to sustain our delivery of the type of interventions that Mr. Whittle is raising with me. But, we do come back. I don't want to sour the atmosphere this morning, but we come back to hard choices here.
Welcome to the government. That's government choices, isn't it?
Well, precisely, and I've made them, which is why I make my point about tax.
That's why I'm challenging you.
I've made a very hard... Well, with the deepest respect, Mr. Whittle is not challenging me. Mr. Whittle is asking me to spend money without showing to me where it's going to come from. unless he wants me to take money out of the health budget and allocate it to local government, he has to come up with an answer for it. And I'm going to challenge the Conservatives on this all the way through this budget process, because the money's got to come from somewhere. And we have an ageing population. We've got a population that has a larger, frailer population, older grouping within it, that will therefore necessarily increase demand in the health service, which is why we're putting more resources into the health service. That's why I increased tax, to make sure I could, yes, increase the money to the health service to address those issues. But I've also got to, you know, Mr Whittle would also want me, he will not disagree with me, about the extra money I've put into the court system to make sure we tackle the backlog so that victims have their cases addressed. He will not disagree with me about putting £550 million extra into local government, but somehow I have to magic out some more money. So these are the hard realities. I've confronted them, but others have got to confront them too.
Final question, if I could, Cabinet Secretary, is around one of the questions we asked the OCD was around data collection and deployment. And that one of the issues of looking forward and looking into potential recovery from COVID and potential issues with future pandemics is that collection of data around not just COVID-related data, but the other conditions that we discussed earlier and where the direction of travel they're going in. And generally speaking, what they said across the OCD, not just within Scotland, that there is a lack of that data, and therefore we haven't gathered that data, we can't disaggregate that data to shape the way in which we tackle the health issues associated with COVID going forward. An IT structure, I've talked about many times, we don't have an IT structure that allows that to happen. In fact, very little, few countries have an IT structure to allow that to happen. Do you think that investment in that area, would you agree with me that investment in that area is something that we should do as a baseline going forward?
I think I think there's a very significant role for a greater use of digital connectivity in our public services, enabling us to better manage information about the way in which people interact with our public services. I think people of Mr. Whittle and my generation have in our minds sort of large, complex IT systems. Of course, you know, we all have phones which have now got very different apps on them with all sorts of flexible information being gathered and utilised and all the rest of it. So I think there are opportunities to better utilise that data. Indeed, if I think about some of the apps I've got on my phone and what they tell me about my own fitness, my health and well-being, how much I'm exercising, sometimes they're reassuring, other times they're a wake-up call. There's a lot that can be done, I think, to try to address these questions. I think, and I'm very open to how we explore that. You know, we do collect a lot of data. We have got access to a lot of data. Whether it's all the right data sets to help us to address some of these questions is a matter of debate. But I'm generally open. Now, it's a critical part of our public service reform agenda and what we're setting out to public bodies, what we're expecting of them as we go through a really challenging spending period, is how adept they are at using digital connectivity to support the finding of the solutions that we're looking for.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to come to Jackie Bailey now, and then I'll go to Jim Fairley.
And I will be very quick. Slightly disjointed, but let me go back to the stat about economically inactive, because I think you'd accept the previous year there was a massive surge. And what happened on Tuesday with the stats is there is a small reduction on what was a very high number. But my question is actually about the National Performance Framework. And I think we agree it reflects the outcomes that we would want to see and want to achieve, but it's not linked to the budget. I understand you're planning a refresh of the NPF this year. Would you take that opportunity to commit to linking the two and generating the additional data required so that actually your money is going to what you say your priorities are, I think that would be a significant step forward, Deputy First Minister.
Well, did that? We went from this is not this is particularly disjointed to this is a series of sweeping generalisations, if I may say
not
so.
Not at all.
On the economic inactivity point, that you know, the data I put on the record is that in 12 months, the level of economic inactivity has fallen in Scotland by 0.8%, and that's a really significant fall, because if you look at economic inactivity, it's sitting, I think the number is 21.3%, if my memory serves me right, from Tuesday. I may not have had that decimal point right, but it's of that order.
It was much higher.
There will be, and Jackie Bailey's saying it was much higher. I don't actually think it was, but I'm going to go away and check the data set.
Okay.
But the point I'm making is that however hard we try, there will be a sizable proportion of that economic inactivity level that will persist, because people genuinely cannot be economically active. And I think we, you know, Jackie Bailey and I would agree on that point. So therefore, getting a fall of 0.8 of a percentage point, let's for example say that economic inactivity, the lowest we could ever hope to get it was, let's say, 15%, right? Which is still a large number, but there are a lot of people who genuinely can't be economically active. A fall of 0.8%, you know, from 22.1 to 21.3, if you know, and the minimum level was 15, that's a very big fall in 1 year.
Which, the illustration, so, though, was that the surge was about long COVID.
I will go and look at the data so that I can complete my view of this. But now, as for this, the other sweeping generalisation, I believe that the choices made in the budget, and I assure Jackie Bailey of this, the choices made in the budget were made cognizant of working to achieve the outcomes in the National Performance Framework. Now, I'm certainly prepared to consider, and this is where I'm not setting out my last word on this. I'm prepared to consider misalignment of budget priorities with the National Performance Framework. When I was answering Mr. Fraser's question about the COVID recovery strategy, and I was saying that I would view it as being mainstreamed, I take that view because the COVID recovery strategy sits comfortably with our aspirations in the National Performance Framework, and the budget likewise sits in there. But I'm very open to discussions about how there may be any misalignment between the budget and the National Performance Framework, and I'm happy to engage on those questions.
And I think Jim Fairley's going to pick this up now.
I apologise, Cabinet Secretary. My questioning has been picking up little bits of all the stuff that's been asked, so you might get jumped about all over the place here, so I apologise. I don't know how much time I've got left, convener.
It'll not be an unusual experience in our conversations,
like
Mr. Fairley.
Exactly. So, that link between the spending review and the budget is one of the things that was talked about by, I can't remember her name, Alfrin Trygve-Dittour, lead spending review machinery of the government, the OECD. So, is that something that you recognise, that there is a problem there? Do you see it as a problem, or is it something that you already had in your radar to look at?
It's something very much. That's why I'm not dismissing the points that Jackie Bailey makes to me, because I recognise the absolute importance of this point. What is the point of a national performance framework if we are not aligning our policy interventions and crucially, the budget that goes with our policy interventions to support those outcomes that we are trying to work? So there must be an alignment there. Now, I would, you know, my contention is that I'm very mindful of that point. My contention would be that in taking budget decisions, I am trying to do as much as I can to align our budget with the successful delivery of progress on those national outcomes in the national performance framework.
Okay.
But if there is a, if there is a balance that we could strike better, if there is an approach, if there is a level of emphasis we could put in particular areas, I'm very open to that conversation. But I do assure the committee that that is an endeavour the government takes seriously.
Okay. Sorry, I'm going to jump around. John had mentioned earlier on, you were talking about the mainstream, the COVID recovery strategy becoming part of the mainstream, and the link between the spending review and how you look back. It was one of the things that we picked up in the previous evidence session. And so the COVID recovery strategy becoming part of the mainstream. One of the comments that came out of the previous session was that a budget is created, it's done, it goes into the budget and it becomes stuck, it's there forever. And as the spending goes on over the years, that bit that you did at that particular time for a particular reason stays there, and the spending review, the way we currently do it, never looks back to say, well, is that spending still relevant? And that kind of was emphasised by the fact, with your response to Murdo, that the COVID recovery strategy funding is now becoming part of the mainstream. Is there a facility for what you guys are doing? You possibly answered this when you spoke to Brian Whittle earlier on, where you go back and say, right, okay, we spent that, we put that in the budget 5 years ago, we put it in 10 years ago. And the point that I highlighted, I'm sorry, this is very rambling, please bear with me. The point that I highlighted is that local authorities will quite often get to the end of their budget year and go, right, we've got to spend £500,000 here to get rid of it so that we don't lose it in our budget. Is there any mechanism that the government currently uses to say, right, are there incentives? That was the phrase that she used. Are there incentives to look at the budgets that you're trying to spend in order to keep them? Are there incentives to not spending them in that way and therefore redeploy them in a more sensible way? I'm sorry if that is very complicated.
I understand exactly the point that's been made. I think the incentive in challenging existing spend is to ensure that spending is properly aligned to the government's objectives.
So do these spending reviews go back?
I look all the time. Finance ministers do it. I'm here in a temporary capacity, but I've had to look very, very hard at financial commitments in this financial year at how we're spending money, because I've had to find money. So I've actively, I've announced this to Parliament, I've taken £1.2 billion out of predicted expenditure within the government. So I've gone to different parts of the government and said, well, those measures can't go forward. I'm going to have to pull that money out. You're going to have to do without this or do without that. So those exercises go on. That's been done in a very abrupt sense because of the financial challenges of this year. But, you know, we do periodic spending reviews where we will review provisions that we are making and things we're funding. So let's take, for example, a programme like early learning and childcare. We've substantially expanded early learning and childcare in the course of the 15 years of this government. You know, when we came to office, I think the level of early learning and childcare provision would be about 425 hours, and we've put that up to 1,140 hours. Now, we've done that on the basis of the early intervention advice. Mm-hmm. The earlier we can engage children in good, high-quality early learning and childcare, all the evidence shows that our educational and personal outcomes, their health outcomes, will be better. So we've made that choice. We've invested in it. If we did a spending review tomorrow, I'm very sceptical that we would come to the conclusion that we're not going to do that any longer.
Yeah.
So, but there will be other things that we do and we're committed to. We might say, well, there is a time limit to what we can afford in these priorities, and we might change them. But that's the active purpose of a spending review, to determine what more we need to do. But a spending review also has to take into account changes in the population. So the point I'm making about, it's a deadly serious point, about the increased number of elderly people in our society, gives, you know, there's a lot of very, very fit, healthy and energetic people who are older in our society, but inevitably there will be people who will become frailer, and there will be more of those individuals, and those individuals have to be supported by our public services, ideally in their own home, mm-hmm. but in some occasions it may well have to be in an acute hospital setting, which is by its nature a very expensive setting to support.
Yeah. Am I okay for that? Yeah. The cost of COVID to Scottish budget, as a result of Brian was making the point that we have bigger challenges because of our distinct health challenges, which our previous witness didn't agree with. Those challenges that we've got, the preparedness for another pandemic, we had previous evidence, and I'm sorry, this is jumping around, I'm picking up pieces. We had previous evidence about PPE. Do you still have the funding available to have that 12-week rolling stock? Because when we took the evidence, it was very much in my mind, if we're going to have a stockpile of it, it'll go out of date, therefore it's a waste. But we were reassured by NHS Scotland, I'm thinking, I'm pretty sure it was NHS Scotland, who said that they have this rolling contract. Is that, because of the budgetary pressures that you're facing, is that under threat at all?
No. We're projecting the maintenance of that 12-week stock, which, as NHS Scotland will have explained to the committee, is done on a rolling basis, is supported by the budget provision. So, you know, the stock isn't, you know, the stock is used, but we've got 12 weeks worth of it, and we are, and we're using the budget to enable that to be constantly replenished. But as it's replenished, at the other end of the warehouse, if I can put it that way, it's been used.
Right. Okay. There's two final quick points I'd like to make, if that was possible. Jackie Bailey's talking about the economic inactivity, something that we've looked at in this committee. And it's anecdotal. I from my own, after we took that evidence, I started talking to people in my peer group, in my age group, saying, why did you retire now? You're mid-early 50s. And there's a definite cohort that came out in the evidence session who were simply not going to go back into employment on the basis of lifestyle, pension provision and all the rest of it. But what I am hearing is, if employers would be far more amenable to part-time, a lot of these economic inactive people who are more than capable of being back into the workforce would do so on a basis that wasn't where it was previously. And I've been given evidence of 240 jobs advertised within a big organisation, and only one of them was part-time. So there's possibly something that the government might want to look at in terms of relationships with industry. Is there ways that you can change the way you're working? That's purely a comment.
Well, I certainly think we should be open to that, because along with the other data I was talking about, employment levels in Scotland are at the highest level on record, and unemployment is at very close to historic low, 3.3%. And as Mr. Fairley will know from his constituency engagement, which is very similar to the profile of my constituency, you can't speak to a local employer without them being short of employees. So we, in whatever sector we happen to talk about, public or private sector. So the need for us to be flexible about engaging people in the workforce, I think, is an absolutely central challenge for us, and the government is doing some work on that in relation to the four-day working week pilot, various other measures of that type. There will, of course, be some complicated interactions around about pension provision, and this is particularly the case in some circumstances in relation to the health service.
Doctors.
And some of those issues are not immediately under our control. They are more pensions rules than they are employment rules. And I think the more we can have an open and constructive dialogue with the United Kingdom government, who will regulate many of these issues, the better to address some of those issues.
OK, one final point, convener.
Couple OK? More minutes.
We took another evidence session, I can't remember which one it was, but it was about data gathering. And we have world-class data, and it goes back to the point that Brian was making, but that link between what that data is and how it is used isn't as strong as it could be in the Scottish Government. Is that something that you could look at?
I'm happy to look at that, but I think we are in a strong position with the data that we've got at our disposal. I think if I look at some of the data that we have through our health records, internationally, I've had so many people commenting to me about the advantage that Scottish data holds and how it can be used, and sequencing information that is able to be applied is quite remarkable to provide us with the intelligence about how we can position various early intervention measures. It's obviously a point that's been reflected on by the Standing Committee on Pandemic Preparedness, led by Professor Morris. So we will continue to look at those questions to make sure that we're using data as effectively as we can.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And that concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Deputy First Minister. I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his supporting officials for their attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be on the 26th of January, when we will be considering a draft report on the labour market inquiry. And I now suspend and move this meeting into private. Thank you.